I have an ethical dog. Does anybody here have an ethical dog at home? I actually realized this just a couple of days ago when Harvey, whose birthday is today, he's two. He's black and white. His one half of his face is black and the other half is white, just like the dog on our gang, Spanky in our gang. And he's a rescue dog who when Karen, my wife and I brought him in, he cowered from me because he was scared of men. He was about a year old. So I've had to slowly work with him to get him to trust me. But now I think he trusts me because of what happened at the fence 2 days ago. We have a fence with a neighbor who has another dog, and Harvey's never seen the other dog, and Harvey only can smell the other dog and hear the other dog, but they don't like each other. And Harvey gets obsessed with sitting by the fence and just poised, listening, moving his head, black face, white face, listening, listening, listening. And my wife, she just doesn't like it when he gets viciously violent and runs up and down the fence and acts like a dog. You know, he just starts running up and down the fence, and the other dog on the other side running up, and there's a lot of barking going on. And my wife's trying to break him of the habit. And so the other day, I was out there, and he was poised. He was ready. And I said, "No, Harvey. Come to me, Harvey. Come to me. Don't do it." And I saw him look at the fence, and then he looked at me, and then he looked at the fence, and he looked at me, and he came running towards me, and I gave him a treat. And I said, "You are an ethical dog. And I am going to talk about you at OK Ethics." I can't believe that we're even in this room with the word ethics behind me. I mean, I've never seen anything quite like this. This is 2 days with nearly 500 Oklahomans who've gathered for lunch in OKC and here to talk about this word, ethics. I just can't believe it, because I come from Texas and we don't do that in Texas. The only way you get an audience this big for a lunch is if you said Emmett Smith was gonna come and be the guest speaker. But I'm so impressed because, you know, our governor, Rick Perry, he was under indictment. He only lasted 2.5 weeks on Dancing with the Stars. I don't know which is worse, you know? And now our attorney general, you probably never heard about our attorney general, but he's under indictment for stealing, well, misleading investors that put money into his investment situation before he became attorney general. But here we are, and I can't really even say that Texas is ethically challenged in Oklahoma, I guess, because that'd be a traitorous act to get up in front of a visiting crowd and down the home. But I can do that, I guess, because I'm not a native Texan. And they never let me forget that. You know how they are. They asked me when I got there in the summer of 93, and don't ever move there in the summer of any year. They said, "Boy, where are you from?" And I didn't realize that that was a trick question. And I would tell them the name of the little town I was from, and they would quote back a Bacante sauce commercial. Do you know that commercial? How did it go? Yeah, New York City. And then they'd get a rope. And I didn't know what they were talking about because I didn't even know what Bacante sauce was, you know? I grew up on Broadway and 78th Street in Manhattan, which is the exact opposite of Tulsa and of Dallas and Fort Worth. And the Texans, I could see they wanted to connect with me because I figured out pretty quickly that they asked me all these questions to find out something that I had in common, and I never had the right answers for them because they'd say, "Well, okay, Yankee boy, what church do you go to?" And I didn't realize that was a super trick question. And I'd answer honestly, I'd say to the person, "I don't go to any church." They go, "Why not, Yankee boy? Don't you believe in the Lord?" And I didn't even know who these people were, and they didn't even know my name. But I go, "No, I do believe in the Lord." "Well, then why don't you go to church?" And I'd give the absolute wrong answer you could give in Fort Worth in 1993, the one that pastor never prepared them for. I'd say, "I don't go to church because I'm Jewish." And they would kind of fall back. But then they would kind of come back real quick because being Texans, it's in the DNA of a Texan to want to connect just like I see it is here too. And they'd say, "Okay, well, I knew a Jewish boy in the Army 20 years ago. Do you know Lieutenant Harry Cohen?" And I say, "No, it's a big tribe." And then they'd ask me, you know, if I was married, and I'd say, no, I'm divorced. And they'd get sort of desperate, and they'd go, do you have kids? And I'd say, no, I don't have any kids. And they'd give up on me. And they'd like walk away shaking their head, and sometimes they'd even put a big L on their forehead. And I didn't have any friends when I got to Texas, which normally wouldn't be a problem at all, but the fact was I was hired to be a columnist at the newspaper, writing three times a week with my picture in the paper. My dream job that I had planned for 22 years to get, I finally got it. First week, I didn't know what to write. I didn't know what makes Texans laugh or cry. I wrote a story that I'm really embarrassed about. I said, hey, everybody, I'm new, and I learned all these new things in my first month here, like a three-word expression, chicken fried steak. What is chicken fried steak, I wrote. Is it chicken or is it steak? Now, this has got to be the stupidest way to introduce yourself to an audience that is already predisposed to not like you to begin with. And they didn't like the story, and they didn't like me, and I don't blame them. They started calling to complain. There was no internet yet, so they faxed in complaints. And one guy called up. I'll never forget my first phone call from Reader. He said his name was Billy Bob Joe Earl Smith. He said, I've been reading the Star Telegram in Fort Worth for 46 years, and that right there is the worst piece of writing I've ever seen, man. Boy, where are you from? What church do you go to? But the problem was really, in a nutshell, I was just too different from everybody because they were like Republican, conservative, Baptist, married, Native Texans. And none of them wanted a newspaper columnist in their face who was a liberal, divorced, Democratic New York City Jew, you know? And that was my dilemma. And I wish I could tell you that I wrote a few columns and everybody thought, oh, this is the coolest cat there ever was. But the truth was, the hatred towards me grew and grew the more I wrote. Because let's face it, every time I went out and learned something, I wrote about it. And every time I wrote about it, I sounded like an imbecile. Like when I wrote about my first Tex-Mex meal, you know, I didn't understand tortillas, enchiladas, fajitas. I mean, they didn't have any of this stuff at my New York deli, you know. Texas-sized margarita, I knew what that was, so. And the clothing was very much of a stumbling block for me because you couldn't go around like this. You had to go around in like a cowboy costume, except they don't call it that. They yelled at me when I called that. They call it Western attire, right? And I went to the Cavenders. Do you have Cavenders? And I went up to the lady at the counter and I asked her if she had cowboy dungarees. Because that's the word in Manhattan that you use to describe those pants is cowboy dungarees. And she said, do you mean coveralls? And I had never heard that word before. I come to find, that's a good Texas expression that I learned. I come to find that coveralls are what 82-year-old men wear to Sears on Saturday. The hat came in a black cowboy hat cake box, and the belt had prongs, and it had a buckle as big as my butt. And the boots came in a purse that you could hold like this, and it came with like this boot remover tool that didn't have any batteries. And the first time I put all the stuff on to go to a party, because it said Western attire, you know, at the party, I looked in the mirror, and it's like I didn't even recognize that guy. There he is, the Jewish Jesse James. And the people talk differently there. You know, everybody says they're fixin', but no one does any fixin'. And y'all is singular when used with the plural of y'all, which is what? Best word ever, all y'all. Because it rhymes, it's backwards and forwards, it includes everybody. Oklahoma State and Oklahoma University. Don't you love all y'all? You know? And then the back of the book that I read, called How to Talk Like a Texan, it said that when I'd meet someone like Shannon Warren, you know, and she'd say, where are you from? What church do you go to? They'd just look at me and they'd just go, oh, bless your heart. And I thought all these really cool women were blessing my heart. But the book said, no, it's the Texas equivalent of the obscene gesture outside the car window, which I was told not to do because you know what they do to you if you do that there, right? They shoot your finger off. And I saw all these people doing this and I didn't know what was going on, you know? So. A complete utter failure as a writer, as an individual, no friends, no family, nothing going on. And the way I got out of this jam was really the smartest thing I ever did in my life. I decided to act like a Texan and do something that the Texans were doing all the time, everywhere. They were getting in trouble for doing it. The Supreme Court told them to stop doing it at high school football games. You know what I'm talking about? Prayer. I decided that if the Texans were praying left and right, the New Yorkers, where I came from, they didn't even never put their hands like this that I ever saw. So I decided to act like a Texan and pray. And I knew what to pray for. I prayed for a date. Because nobody would fix me up with their friends or their relatives, because it'd be like, I know a guy you could go out with. He's a Jewish columnist from New York that nobody likes. And they'd go, no, that's okay. And you know what happens when you pray, right? I mean, it really does work. I found it works in Texas especially well. The Rangers, the Texas Rangers baseball team went from last to first last year. It doesn't work all the time, because Jerry Jones is still the general manager. But I was introduced a week after the prayer to this marvelous woman, Karen, who came with these two kids, a young boy and a young girl, and they live with this dog, a different dog than my little Harvey guy that I told you about at the beginning. Her name was Sadie. I have a picture of her here. And the kids really liked me, I think, and Karen and I fell in love immediately. But the dog hated my guts, because the dog was a native Texan. And she would just look at me like, you know, I've got a little doggy house for her to sit in, because I've found that when you're a speaker and you have a dog with you, it makes it more like you're at home. So I want you to just stay, okay? So, you know, everything was going great with this family and this dog. Even the dog didn't like me, but that's okay. But after going out with him 6 months, I decided to propose marriage. And since I had to write 3 columns in the newspaper every week, I decided to propose in the newspaper. And the boss said, you can't do that. And I said, why? And she said, because we don't give personal details like that. And I said, look, it doesn't really matter. These people out there hate me. And she said, oh yeah, what happens if Karen says no? Then what? I go, I'll run a correction box, you know? So I wrote the story, you know, and it started off by saying, here in Texas, I've met the woman of my dreams. Unfortunately, she lives with the dog of my nightmares. And then the end said, now I know there's more to life than just you, me, the boy, the girl, and the doggone little dog. And I ended by saying, will you marry me? And everybody read it, because it was about a dog and it had a surprise ending. And then they started calling the newspaper to find out. They go, what'd that girl say, that Yankee boy? And there was no internet yet. It was a year before the internet came to our homes. So they called me up and they said, we've got to tell everybody what's going on, because we can't wait for your next article. So this is what they came up with 1 year before the internet. They had an electronic message board on Airport Freeway to DFW Airport. And it said, read the Star Telegram in lights. And then it said, time 4:51, temperature 81 degrees. Karen says yes. And if it's possible, you know, every problem that a man could ever have in life just, you know, went away 22 years ago when the marriage proposal came out, and then 21 years of marriage. And now we have our own son that we named him Austin, and you know why we named him Austin, right? Because Waco and Waxahachie, you know, doesn't sound good, you know. So there I was, finally getting accepted, because now I had a family and I was getting normal, and Karen was turning me into a normal Texan and showing me how to be polite, which she still teaches me because I'm still from New York, and everything was going great, really until about 2005 and 2006, when I noticed that the world seemed suddenly to be going to hell. And what I mean by that was that things that you could count on to come to help you were no longer countable. They were no longer countable. I made that word up. And what I mean is that it seemed like you couldn't trust anybody to do anything right the first time. They had to come back, and the bill was always wrong, and the people on the phone were always deceptive, and people were just starting to play mind games with us as consumers. And I was getting ripped off by the electric company, because in Texas you can shop for electricity, and I was getting ripped off by the phone company because I didn't know about my 10% corporate discount. No one told me. I didn't figure it out. The plumber had to come back 3 times, you know. Everything was going wrong. And at the same time, I was given this job to be the watchdog at the newspaper, writing 2 columns a week where I expose corruption in business and government. So on the one hand, I'm seeing in my personal life everything. And then on the other hand, I'm getting letters from people, probably 200 a week, which I have since 2005, 200 letters a week from people that write, "Dear Mr. Newspaper Columnist, I've got a problem I can't solve. Can you help me?" Of those 200 a week, you know, 50 of them are about AT&T, but that's another story. And so it all came to a giant explosion in my life when the hailstorm hit. And that's a whole nother subject, which, you know, there's no hail in Manhattan. I know you guys invented hail here. And the hailstorm hit and we needed a new roof, and I started to have a little panic attack because I know how to hire a roofer logically from the newspaper articles I write, but I didn't really want to go through all the checks that you have to do to hire a roofer, because in Texas we don't have licensed roofers like you have everywhere else in the world here. So the first roofer I hired turned out to be a moron, and he got my address mixed up, and he went to the house behind me, and the neighbor came over that night and said, "Were you expecting a roof?" And I said, "Yeah." He goes, "Well, they put it on my house instead of yours." I'm not kidding. I mean, and the roofer tried to get my neighbor to pay for it, like through insurance. And I told my neighbor, "You're not doing that because, you know, the guy, just ignore the guy." And he goes, "Why?" And I go, "Because he's not going to sue you, because he doesn't want anyone to know that he screwed up like that. So just forget about it." And my neighbor said, "Well, how do you know?" And I go, "Because I'm the watchdog." He said, "What's that?" You know. So I had a chance to hire a second roofer, okay? And I did something that none of you, looking at your faces, none of you have ever done. I shortcut the search because I didn't have time. I was busy at work with all the letters about AT&T. And so I called up my insurance agent and I said, "Hey man, I don't know what to do. I had a bad roofer. I got out of the contract. Can you recommend a roofer?" And he says, "Yeah, I got this guy, Sean Tatum in Arlington, Texas. Call him." And I called him and I ended up committing an illegal act, is what happened. Because Tatum sent over his sales manager, who told me as a sales enticement that he would give me a free roof. And he would pay my deductible and everything. And I didn't know that the law in Texas said you can't pay for someone else's deductible. So I bragged to Karen that I got a free roof. And I was really proud of myself. And you know, she just basically rains out my parade. And she said, you said there's no such thing as a free anything. And I said, "Yeah, but they really liked me." I mean, I was just a dummy. And you know, what ended up happening is they put us off for a really long time. And then they finally put a roof on our house after 6 months of me calling and complaining. And then right after they put the roof on, he filed bankruptcy. And then right after he filed bankruptcy, he was indicted for criminal theft. And I was like listed as one of the witnesses and one of the creditors, even though I got a roof. And I got a hold of the crew boss and I said, "How come I got a roof and all these other people that didn't get a roof?" And he goes, "Oh," he said, "Tatum found out what you do for a living." He said, "We better put a new roof on this guy's house before we shut down or he'll write bad about us in the newspaper." So I'm governed by ethics, and so the first thing I knew I needed to do is I needed to rip the roof off the house and donate it to a church, you know? Karen said, "What you should really do about it is you should write an article about him right away because he doesn't want you to." And I did. And he ended up going to prison, which never happens in Texas. You know, nobody goes to prison there except for the poor people. The criminals and the scammers don't ever get caught because nobody's chasing them. Which is why I was running that little campaign for president, which you can see didn't work. So I wrote a story about Tatum roofing, how he's ripping off people. And then I looked in the mirror and I thought of that Michael Jackson song, you know, "Man in the Mirror, Didn't Like What I See." And I thought, you're the watchdog and you're supposed to be the one that protects everybody and shows them. And I thought, I gotta figure out a better way to protect myself. And if I can figure out a way to do it for me, then I can share it with everybody. And it just took me about a year. I began to look at all the emails and letters that I got from people and I began to detect patterns. And I created something that I call Watchdog Nation, which is a virtual world where everybody is a super consumer. And the beautiful thing about Watchdog Nation is it's free. And it takes just a few seconds to do. There's no lawyers involved or anything at all. It's just saying the right thing at the right time to the right people, and you get to be a super consumer. And it really works. And I unveiled it in 2008, and I guess so this is the eighth year. And I've taught it to thousands and thousands and thousands of people, mostly seniors, because they're the ones that need it the most. But not to say that you young ones in the room, and I'm saying anyone in the room who's under 80 is a young one. Not to say you aren't vulnerable, because the truth is that all the scammers in the world, and I'm talking about out-and-out crooks who hide in call centers overseas and call you and pretend to be IRS agents, and I'm also talking about some of America's best-known corporations. If you ask me who are the scammers, I'd say look at the sponsors of the Olympics. Because all those companies that you see, those car companies, those banks, those credit cards, they're all the ones that I get mail about, because they're all doing deceptive things to their customers. So I want to show you today how Watchdog Nation works. And the good thing about it is you'll all be saying to yourself, well, I do that. Well, I do that. Oh, I don't do that enough. And then maybe on one of them you'll go, I never did that before, but I'm going to do that from now, and no one will ever mess with me again. Because that's what Watchdog Nation is. And there's probably 100 principles of Watchdog Nation, but we're going to go over the five basic ones today, because they're the ones that basically keep you out of trouble for the rest of your life. I'm not going to talk to you about committing ethics practices in your company, because I think that's probably what you talk about here the rest of the year. And I'm going to assume that your company cares about ethics very much, because you're actually here. And I can't believe that you're here and you just had a meeting 2 weeks ago and you're still here in the room today. But one of the things I learned yesterday when I went to the museum in OKC in a trip that Shannon Warren arranged is there's something that I never heard of before called the Oklahoma Standard. And I didn't know what that was. And it says, according to, I looked it up, I studied a little bit about it. It says that you show generosity beyond generosity and you give till you never can stop giving. Isn't that what it is? That's really cool. That's really cool. So the reason I'm here is really for the same exact reason, for the Oklahoma Standard. I didn't know what it was called, but just like you, I was brought up to believe the world was a good place. And when we were kids, it was much easier to navigate because people were more honest with you. And you'd actually go to the bank. This is fun for the young ones. You'd actually go to the bank and they'd give you gifts that you could plug into the wall if you would sign up with them. And the bank would call you on the phone and talk to you about your account so you wouldn't bounce a check because the teller knew you personally. And one time, I remember going to the bank in West Virginia at one of my first newspaper jobs, and they pulled a toaster out. And they said, if you open a savings account, we will give this to you. And I couldn't believe it. I was like, oh my God, a toaster. And the thing was, you know, a lady one time said to me, I got an electric carving knife set from a bank. And I said, you will never get an electric carving knife set from a bank ever again. And she said, why? And I said, because they're afraid you'll use it on them. Because the bank doesn't call you on the phone anymore and tell you you're about to bounce a check. They made $30 billion a couple of years ago from all their customers and overdraft fees and everything. And I'm not talking about the local banks here in the state. I'm talking about the super banks that we know, like, you know, Chase and Bank of America. I used to go to the mailbox and I would get a letter from a bank or a credit card company or a cable company or AT&T that would be $100 or $200 over what I knew the bill was supposed to be, and I knew I was going to have to call customer service in some foreign country, and I would literally have a panic attack and I would start to shake. I'd be so angry, and the neighbors would drive by and go, look, there's Dave, he got his electric bill again. And I'd run upstairs and Karen would say, what's the matter? And I'd say, I just got mugged at the mailbox from the bank and I have to call them. And the phone call was always so painful. It was like, you know, the guy would go, you know, what I'd want him to say, hey, how are you? Whatever you need, I'm here for you. But instead he'd say, what is your name? What is your account number? What are the last four digits of your passcode? What is your mother's maiden name? What's your amount of the date of the last deposit? How many tattoos do you have on your backside? And then, you know, you'd beg the guy, oh, please help me, give me back my money. That's what it's like when we call 1-800 numbers. Give me back my money, my router, my cable box. The guy has 90% of the power, and you have 10% of the power. But in Watchdog Nation, you quickly close the gap from 90-10 to 50-50, just with a couple of things on the phone. And the whole goal of Watchdog Nation is to become that one out of 100 that they deal with that's a pain in the butt. And this is how you do it. Well, let me start off with principle number one. The fundamental principle of Watchdog Nation, of which none of it could exist if this one didn't work. And it's represented by this box. This box represents the greatest invention of my lifetime. I guess the iPhone is the greatest invention, but this I call the magic Google box. Because could you remember what life was like before Google box came into your life? I mean, you couldn't figure out anything. You had to go to the library. You had to trust your gut instinct. But now all you got to do is do this, which I didn't do. Sean Tatum Roofing, Arlington, Texas, and Scam. Sean Tatum Roofing, Arlington, Texas, and Ripoff. Sean Tatum Roofing, Arlington, Texas, and Complaints. Scam, Ripoff, and Complaints, with his name and his location. And if I had done that, instead of trusting my eventually fired insurance agent, I would have seen that some people were complaining about him already. And by the way, Lynn, the Wi-Fi connection in this is really good. So I figured out that this was a major problem because people would write me letters. They'd say, "Dear Mr. Lieber, I have a serious problem. I gave $50,000 to a financial advisor, and he took the money and moved to Costa Rica. And here's a website that explains it. I wish I had Googled him first. Please expose him." And I'd write back and say, "Well, why didn't you Google him before you gave him the 50K? And you would have seen this." And they say, "Well, because we met him at church and he seemed like a really nice guy," or something like that. And so I just figured out, you just got to Google everything that you're about to buy that probably costs more than $20. And you got to, anybody you're about to hire to come to your house to work or at your business, you got to Google them too. And it sounds so simple, but if you forget the 1 out of 10 times, you miss the obvious one. And the reason that we don't do it naturally is because we didn't grow up with it. We shop, until then, we shop just like our great-great-great-great-grandparents did with our instincts. We went and we squeezed the melon, and we looked at the price, and we smelled it, and we thought about how it tasted last time we bought it, and whether it's in season, and how much it costs at the competitor across the street. And we make a gut instinct to buy that piece of fruit just by gut instinct. And that's fine. But if you buy an LG refrigerator like that, you're asking for trouble. I know that because my wife and I went to the Sears outlet store to buy a new refrigerator a few years back, and she fell in love with the LG, and it had a dent on the side, so it was a lot cheaper, and it had French doors, and it had a pull-out. Oh my gosh, she fell in love with it. And she was about to say, "This is the one." I said, "Hold on, we gotta Google it. LG refrigerator 9173R purchased at Sears outlet, any complaints, ? And about 120 complaints came up on this website, and I showed it to her, and she said, "I hate being married to the watchdog." So now she buys stuff without telling me. But I don't blame her, because she rescued me, right? So I wouldn't be, there'd be no Watchdog Nation. No happy home means no way to teach people how to be consumer revolutionaries. So that's number one, simple as heck. Look in the box, check it out, rip off complaints, and scam next to the name. If you're about to buy something in a store, find out what other people say when they bought the same thing in the same store. And if you find something, great, but if you don't, then you go in there and you feel cool about it. But that's number one. Number two is I told you that you don't need to spend any money on Watchdog Nation, that it was free. But I do take that back, because you need to buy a tool to make number two work, and that's this blank sheet of paper. You got to go out and buy a blank sheet of paper. And as soon as you get that letter from that company that's driving you crazy, AT&T, I write on the top of the sheet the name of the company, AT&T. And now I've created a power sheet. And that's number two, which is make them accountable to you with a power sheet. And the reason I came up with this was because I noticed that people, myself included, we'd get into these little scrapes with these companies, and we'd call them quickly on the phone to work it out, and we'd be writing the information on the back of envelopes, and we're writing it on the margins of those magazine subscription cards that fall out. Just little yellow post-it notes that you have 12 of them and you stick them all together. And it wasn't organized. And I figured, if you want to beat up AT&T, you got to be organized, because they're like certainly almost organized, right? So AT&T, and then you call up the number, and we've all done this, called customer service. It's a 1-800 number, and you get the guy on the phone. And when he says, you know, to you, "What's your name? What's your secret account number? How many people are on the account? How many tattoos do you have on your butt?" All that. Then, you know, you should say to him, "I'm going to reach my hand through the wire and strangle you if you don't give me back my overdraft fees, because that's improperly taken from my account." But that's not what you say. You say, "Please help me." But in Watchdog Nation, this is what you say. You say, "Okay, thank you. Before I tell you my story, why I'm calling, I need to get some information from you." And then you ask him that question that he hates it when you ask, which is what? Yeah, and he won't tell you his name, because he's like, these are stupid people. I don't have to worry about them. And what he does is he tells you the fake name. And I figured out the fake name scam when I talked to the guy from Linksys Wireless Router in Bangalore, India, who told me his name was Elvis. E-L-V-I-S. He doesn't care that you wrote his fake name down. And then I say, Elvis, what's your company ID number? And he says, you don't need one. You're going to get a reference number. And I said, I do need one. My name's Dave. I'm from Texas. You know my name and my number. What's your number? There might be more than one Elvi in your organization. And then he gives you the number, and you go like this. You go, he goes real fast. He goes 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12. Then you go, hold on, Elvis, I got to get it down. What's the first number? 2? Okay, hold on. 2. That's my favorite number, Elvis. I got 2 kids. What's the next number? 4. And you will hear Elvis go, he'll sound like my dog. And that's good, because that gives you like 20 points. So now it's like, instead of 90-10, it's 70-30. And then you say, okay, Elvis, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16. Last month, I talked to Sheila, number 1357911. And she told me, she's in Venezuela office, and she told me she was going to fix this, and she didn't. Do you know her? So now he's not sure. Like, he thinks you are the dumbest person. But so his guard is a little dropped. So you say, okay, Elvis, I'm going to tell you my problem. It's October 6th at 12:32 p.m. Central Time. I'm talking to Elvis, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12. And I want you to know, sir, that I'm taping this call for customer quality control. And Elvis goes, and then he says, that's all right, Mr. Lieber. Or is it Lieber? Because suddenly he cares, because now I'm the 1 out of 100. He thinks I'm taping the call. He thinks I have a power sheet. I do have a power sheet, but I'm not taping the call because it's not worth it, really. I do tape the AT&T calls and put them on the internet and embarrass them, but that's my own little hobby. You're laughing, but my hobby got me called into the office of the CEO, President, Chairman of the Board of AT&T back in March. He called me, the CEO of AT&T called me on my AT&T telephone and said that he really objected to my hashtag shame ATT campaign. And he called me in and he said he wanted to show me how much he cares about customer service. And I explained to him on the phone that every day for the past 10 years I've gotten a complaint about his company and it annoys me. And he said, well, come in, and I did, and I showed him all the complaints that I got for the past 100 days in a red book. I cut off the people's names and email addresses so their privacy would be protected. And I said, this is how good you are at your job. And I pushed it over. And he said, I'm calling your publisher about you. But they printed my story. So ask a bunch of questions. And that's what number 4 is. It's my favorite one. I made a button for it because I noticed that Texans were not asking a bunch of questions, because I, just like you, Texans are unbelievably polite. They do things that I've never seen human beings do before. If two people are talking in a hallway and a Texan walks in between them to get to wherever they're going, they say, excuse me, I don't mean to walk in. And you do that here, right? In Manhattan, we take our elbow and we pop the guy on the left, we pop the guy on the right, pop, pop. And that's how we get on the subway. And I just figured if I could get the Texans to just ask a couple more questions before they give up and buy, like I said, act like Detective Columbo. He used to pretend he was finished. Detective Columbo on TV would go to the door. He'd say, thank you very much. And then he'd say, just one more question. Just one more question. And then he'd nail the murderer. And that's just 2 extra questions. And what I'm about to show you now is, if you forget everything else we've talked about with Watchdog Nation, this is the one thing to remember, because this shows it in a story. And that's what I really am. I tell stories in the newspaper, and I tell stories in my talks, and I actually coach companies like yours on how to tell their story better. So if you guys are ever looking for a speaker on a conference, please think of me. But watch this story. In the box, I kept the symbol of American wealth. Let me just fix it here for a second. Time out. Okay. There we go. I should have done this before. Okay. The symbol of American wealth, right? Everybody see this in the back? Starbucks. The reason I call it the symbol of American wealth is because anybody that can get you to spend $6 on a cup of dirty water with whipped cream on top and a little bubble dome, that's like a definite, right? I mean, that markup is something that you all would love to have in your business. And when you walk into Starbucks, how many sizes of coffee do they sell you on the menu? Three. They actually have this fourth size now called a Trenta. You ever hear this? If you drink this size, you'll die, you know? Everything about what's wrong with American consumer is I didn't do it right. It's hard. I only have two hands. And I'm left-handed. You'll see what I was doing in a second. Everything wrong with consumerism is really illustrated here, because what do they call the large? Right, and I don't even know what venti is. I mean, it's like a word on a thing, I don't know. It's like, that doesn't, it's Italian. And then they don't call the medium a medium. What do they call the medium? And what does grande mean in Spanish? So I would say to Starbucks, how dare you change the meaning of the word to confuse unsuspecting Americans and get us to pay too much for coffee? Because grande is not medium, but at Starbucks it is. And the first time I went to Starbucks, I told her, I don't know what the words are. I'll just give me a small cup of coffee. And she said, we don't have that here. We have a what? Barista, listen to me. I don't want a tall. I want a small. And she says to me, tall is small. And those are bad words. So here's what everybody orders in Starbucks world, because that's what's on the menu. And I'm just going to put that up here. But remember what I said about asking two extra questions. Okay, two extra questions. The first question I'm going to ask the Google box is, what's the secret size cup at Starbucks called? Question mark. Because you know companies have secret menus now that are only on the internet. Like, does anyone know the secret size, what it's called at Starbucks? I heard someone over there say it. Who said the short? Who said short? Rex, how did you know it's called a short? How? How'd you cheat? That's not cheating. Oh my God, give Rex a hand. He looked it up. So this is the tall, but Rex, who cheated with the Google box, he goes into the barista and he says, I just want a short cup coffee of the day. And they reach under the counter and they pull this out. And most people have never seen this size cup because it's hidden under the counter, it's not advertised, and they don't know about it. And it's a quarter less than the tall, and it gets you climbing off the ceiling like a chimichanga. What is a chimichanga anyway? I don't. So the second question I'm going to ask, and the final question, because it really only takes two extra questions. How do I drink coffee for free at Starbucks? Question mark, enter. And a word pops up. And if you know the word, you get free coffee. Does anybody know it? Want to guess? No, it's a good guess. Starbucks, senior. But remember, this is about corporate deception. You say to the barista, can I please have a sample of the coffee of the day? They reach under the counter and they pull out this. See why I had to organize my cups better? And so the way you drink coffee for free at Starbucks, and this is part of Watchdog Nation, is you take the coffee and you go to the barista, thank you so much. And then you come back out and you say, can I have a sample of that one? And you get a second cup and you're flying off the ceiling like you know a chimichanga. And you can get everything for free in this cup in Starbucks except for the Frappuccino, because they will not give you a free Frappuccino in here. Do you know why? No room. Smart answer, probably the true answer, but in Starbucks world the answer is because they have another secret cup. Have you ever seen this cup? It's the clear cup, and then there's the sample cup, and then there's the short, right? But everybody in the world because that's what's on the menu. I am only able to order what's on the menu because I don't know what Dave's Watchdog Nation is, and I don't know that you could ask a couple of questions and get free stuff. And it's really, this is really not about Starbucks, because honestly, you know I could care less if you save a quarter. But this is about the airplane trip that you're going on. You're on the same plane. You paid $56 for the ticket, you paid $95, you paid $140, you paid $500, you paid $1,100 because of a funeral, and I'm sorry. You know, electricity in Texas, we're all shopping, not like you. We have 55 companies to choose from. You're paying 4 cents a kilowatt hour, you're paying 12 cents, you're paying 16 cents a kilowatt hour, and you don't know what you're paying. Because that's the way the world's structured, so that everybody pays a different thing, because nobody realizes that they really have this place to go, and in 5 minutes, they can probably save more money in 5 minutes than you can make in an hour at work, because that's just how it's set up for us. It's set up to fool us, and it's set up that only the 1 out of 100 kick butt. So that's number 4. My story on Watchdog Nation is how to ask a bunch of questions. But number 5 is the one that I sort of hesitate to tell you, because it's the mean one, it's the nuclear one. And you're also nice and positive. I mean, your name or your group is called OK Ethics, and to me it's not Oklahoma Ethics, it's Ethics OK. OK, we don't have to be mean to people. We can be nice and accomplish what we want, because we believe in the Oklahoma standard. Well, just for the next one, you're gonna have to think like you're a New Yorker for a moment, okay? Because number 5 is the one that everybody forgets. I'm sure you all are going, I've done the first 4, but number 5 is the one that people kind of get roadblocked on, and I have to show them how to do it. Number 5 is when the first 4 fail, find their pressure point and squeeze. How do you do this to AT&T? Well, I figured it out because somebody one time did it to me. They literally grabbed me by my neck, this county commissioner in Pennsylvania, a rough state where I worked. They grabbed me by the neck, the guy didn't like what I wrote, and he just started to squeeze. And my first split second thought was, I can't believe he's doing that. He's a former Marine, he knows exactly where my pressure point is. This hurts so much. My second split second was, I'm gonna reach around, grab him by the throat, and say, you don't touch a member of the press. But instead what happened was I went like this, oh. And I remember, I finally let go, and I got up, and I was in such shock that this had happened that I didn't know what to say or do, and I remember just walking out. And it never happened before, it never happened since, but a week later, the neck still was sore. So 25 years later, I'm thinking, how can I do that for that to AT&T? And what I realized was that pretty much everybody that we answer to, everybody that we work with in life, where we buy stuff from and where we hire stuff to do, they answer to somebody else. But we don't know who it is because we're not lawyers. We don't know the intricacies of the law. But they're permitted. They're audited. They might be certified. They might be registered. They might be licensed. There's 5 other designations of overseeing that people have to get involved in whatever it is they do. How many of you have licenses? Yeah, a lot of work. So let's say you bought that refrigerator because you didn't Google it. And sure enough, a couple of years later, it broke. I know this is an example that nobody here can relate to because nobody ever had a broken refrigerator. And you have a home warranty company, which I have, where I pay now $90 a month to this home warranty company to fix just about anything that goes wrong in my house. And I say just about because that's what happens. They come over and they go, we fix everything except that, just about everything but that. We don't fix that. And so you call, you follow my principles. You call on the phone and you raise hell and you speak to Sheila and you speak to Elvis and you speak to the supervisor. And nothing seems to work. So you Google and you say, who regulates home warranty companies in Oklahoma? Who regulates home warranty companies in Texas? And sure enough, in my case, the Texas Real Estate Commission pops up. It says, we regulate them, we license them, we audit their books, and if you have a complaint, click here. And you click, and you fill out the form, and you send it off, and it flies through the air with the state government seal of gold imprimatur on it. It's no longer that annoying person who keeps calling on the phone. Now you are OK 2016-4739501. And you get a phone call from the home warranty company, always. And they say, yeah, Mr. Lieber, this is Calvin from Home Warranty, and you know, we made a big mistake. You know, we're going to come over and fix your your refrigerator for free as a one-time customer courtesy, and Elroy's going to have a letter for you to sign if when we're done with you. And I'd say, well, what does the letter say? And he says, oh, you're going to drop the complaints with the real estate commission because our license is up for renewal and they're auditing us and the boss wants to clear complaints. And you know what you say to them?
Would you please hold on?
And then you play music. So you all have really been trained. Did I mention, Karen, about the taping the phone calls? Or I skipped over that? Okay, one other thing I forgot to tell you. With the power sheet, you tell them, I think I did, you tell them you're taping the phone calls. Yeah, I did tell you. So you're all trained, really, on the five basic principles of Watchdog Nation. And for that training, you're all going to get number three, which was find their point of vulnerability. That's right. Okay, sorry. Number three is basically to figure out the one thing about your problem that they don't want you to know. And you just Google it. And you find out right away that there's an attorney general investigation going on in Idaho, or the Oklahoma City office of blankety blank is regulating them and investigating, or there's a columnist like me or a TV reporter on YouTube that did a report about them. And you call them and you say, hey, I got a power sheet here. I've talked to all these people. I see that the Idaho attorney general is investigating you. I'm going to tell him about you, and I'm taping this call for customer quality control, supervisor. And they go,
would you please hold on?
And you have 80% of the power and they have 20% because you've now told them what you know about their point of vulnerability, which is the one place on their armor that you can. So everybody has a point of vulnerability, but we forget to look. So that's number five, which was whatever it was. So you've all been trained, and I have a ID card for you, for each one of you on the table over there, that I'd like you to just take as a gift from me, which basically gives you the power of the press in your pocket. Here's how it works. It says you're a citizen. It certifies that you're a citizen of Watchdog Nation, and it has my contact information on the back. And you forget about this card. You just put it in your purse or your wallet, and then like a year from now, you're going to go to the garage to pick up your car repairs, and they're not going to want to give you your car back because they're going to say it's twice as much as you were told. And you say, but you only told me it was going to be this. And they go, well, I'm sorry, but if you want your car, otherwise it's $40 a day. You just pull out the card and you say, do you know who I am? I am part of the OK Ethics Group and a citizen of Watchdog Nation, and I'm friends. I had sausage. The hard part, Shannon, comes when they go to the bathroom to try and wash their hands and try and activate the sinks in this hotel. None of them. So you say, do you know who I am? I'm friends with the guy at the paper, and he puts stuff on the internet, and he writes about people like you, and here's his contact information, and he told me that if I ever meet anybody like you, to let him know, because he might want to write about it and put you on the internet forever, do you want to mess with me? And you twirl it. And if you have arthritis and you can't do this, then you can use two hands, but you should go home and practice this. And it works, because they don't want to be on Yelp. They don't want to be on DallasNews.com. They don't want to be on WatchdogNation.com. And you just say, look, I know the guy, and he'll write about you, because this is wrong. And they're like, okay, no, it's okay. That's what happens, because that's what happened to the first person who did it. A very older woman in Fort Worth called me and said, you don't know me, but I went to the car place, and they tried to rip me off, and I told him I knew you. And he gave me my car back even lower than he said originally, and I just want to thank you, and I hope you don't mind that I made that up. And I said, made that up? I'm going to order 1,000 cards. So let me wrap up, because I finish on time, because you all have to go back to work, which really stinks on a Friday. By the way, you don't have to go back to work. You tell them the watchdog said you could have the day off. I wrote a book called Watchdog Nation, where I teach everybody how to do this on just about every kind of industry. There's an index in the back, so there's the washing machines, breaks down, the insurance, the car repairs, all this stuff on how to talk to people. I brought some copies with me if anybody'd like it. They're $20 each, and I've got a credit card machine, yes. And I'll sign it for you. It makes a good Christmas present because it works here, it works everywhere. It's not just Texas-centric. Got the card free for everybody. Sometimes people say, Dave, I don't have time to read a book because I'm so busy. And I go, I know all about you. That's why I made it in a double CD set so you can listen in the truck. And And I've written 6 books, but I only brought 2 with me, and this is my other favorite book. It's called The Dog of My Nightmares, and it starts off with the marriage proposal. Then it has about 100 stories that are real short that are good for bedtime reading, just about funny, weird things I've seen and done with people. And this is only $10 a paperback. And I've got an audio version. So I'll hope to see you at the table, pick up a card and everything. I guess the last thing to do, besides thanking Shannon and Lynn for the great hospitality and everybody being so wonderful here, is to swear you in as citizens of Watchdog Nation. And this is a quick oath. There's no penalty of perjury for it or forgery or any other kind of urgery. You just have to raise your right hand and repeat after me. Say aye.
Aye.
Oops. Oops. Those cups are killing me.
Aye.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
That as a new citizen of Watchdog Nation. I will preserve, protect, and defend the rights of myself, my family, and my friends against what President Bush called the evildoers. Congratulations, you are citizens of Watchdog Nation. Thank you. Shannon says, can you tell them about America's Funniest Home Videos? Essentially, I fell off the stage in a tuxedo, and the father in the audience who was taking a picture of his kid at the talent show was waiting for the kid to come on, and there's this tuxedo penguin just going straight off the stage, 9 feet, shoo, into the orchestra pit, and it made America's Funniest Videos, and I didn't get the prize or anything, but the producer told me, and this is a story in my Dog of My Nightmares book, the producer told me it was one of the best falls I ever saw on America's Funniest Home Videos. That's like an Olympic gold medal, you know? Lynn.
You also have to tell them where was one of your first, places they sent you.
Okay, so this tells you a little bit about Lynn, that she would ask this question. She said, tell them about one of the first places you were sent as a reporter, because she knows the answer, and the answer was 3 days in a nudist colony. And I was 22 years old and didn't really know what was going on, and it was horrible. And she loves that story. But I hope that you'll maybe follow some of my stories. You can just Google me and my stories come up, and I write about things that are interesting to you too, because they're the same kind of problems that you have here. But I'm a troublemaker, as you can tell, and I believe that you can kick up a lot of dust without actually being mean about it. That's the Texan in me now. I've learned how to be nice and at the same time that I'm kind of twisting the knife a little bit. And that's pretty cool for a New Yorker. But I just want to say again, thank you for having me. And I've really learned a lot about Oklahoma on this trip, and it's all been good. Thank you. Aww.